First public hearing and consideration for case SU-15-02, an ordinance approving a request from Carl Wirth to authorize a special use to allow for accessory structures on approximately 1.53 acres out of a 155.78 acres located at 2602 Red Bluff Road on property more commonly referred to as La Fiesta Isle or Rattlesnake Island, which is actually a peninsula. Your own, Ms. Rebecca.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor, City Council. Rebecca Guerra, Planning Manager. First item before you is, in fact, SU-1502 in the name of Carl Wirth. It is 1.53 acres out of an overall 155.78 acres that is owned by the city. So again, we're only talking about a very specific portion of this overall acreage, which is approximately 1.53 acres, as you can see in the depiction before you and in your staff reports. It is known as Rattlesnake Island. It is a peninsula, but it's also known on the lease as La Siesta Isle. It is in single member district number one, and it is located in the Nasworthy neighborhood, as it is adjacent to Lake Nasworthy. The future land use designation of this site is open space. The site, however, is surrounded by properties with a future land use designation of neighborhood, which correlates to generally single family residential. The zoning for this site is RS1. So I'm going to take a moment to explain to you why the RS1 zoning was assigned. There is no particular park designation in the city yet. So properties, in fact, almost every single park that we have in the city is designated RS1 zoning district, which is residential zoning district. In this case, the properties, as you can see before you, almost entirely are zoned RS1 single family residential district. So in fact, this site, which we lease out, as is the overall 153 acres, which this is part of, 155 acres, is zoned RS1 zoning district. Staff's recommendation is denial of special use to allow for residential accessory structures without a principal structure, and that's in fact what the applicant is asking for. On this peninsula, Rattlesnake Island, which is being leased from the city, they wish to put on some residential structures, maybe a carport, a shed, accessory structures without having an actual house or dwelling unit correlated or related to these accessory structures. So that's the request that's before you today. So what was staff's rationale? This is based entirely from the zoning ordinance, and these are the criteria that have to be met for any special use that's being requested before this city council. It's located on a peninsula or an island. So no buffering is being proposed by the applicant. The applicant is proposing to do any fencing around these structures as they go up. And there will be no principal structure to buffer these. So the only thing that you will see from the lake, or if you're adjacent to the property, is these residential structures without a house accessorizing it, or principal to it. The accessory structure, according to zoning ordinance, any accessory structure shall be, quote, incidental and subordinate to a principal structure. In fact, that's the whole point. When you're in RS1 zoning district, accessory structures should be accessory to a principal structure. They should not be the standalone use on any piece of property. If this will be permitted, staff believes it's a means to circumvent those very restrictions that were placed within the zoning ordinance for a reason. The area is surrounded, as I said previously, by other RS1 zoning districts. No other sites, no other residential sites in the immediate area would allow for this to happen without a special use being granted. And in fact, no other special uses have been granted for this site to have that. We believe that more vehicular traffic could occur if the special use were granted. Recreational vehicles could come out. It could be used more extensively by the lessees. And the roadway which would be affected, which is in fact Red Bluff Road, is built at 32 feet versus the 40 feet that is required in the major thoroughfare plan for any local road. And this is the case for many of the roads in the Lake Nasworthy area. They were built not according to the standards which were passed within the major thoroughfare plan for a local road. The effects of putting these permanent structures on the site, you could have more noise, you could have a lighting impact, and it's unlikely to have a review of any kind of drainage or stormwater issues simply because of the small scale of the development. Staff isn't likely to go out there and see what these additional impacts may or may not have on the site or on adjacent properties. There doesn't appear to be a community need. There are nearby park facilities, boat vehicle storages, And the applicant already enjoys some recreational uses on the site. You can go out to that. There's a boat dock. There's a concrete pad. There's a picnic table. There's some barbecue benches. Temporary canopies or temporary shade can be brought out there so that the applicants can enjoy it and can take it down when they're done. We believe that there are alternative means other than a permanent structure being erected onto the site for the applicant to be able to enjoy the use of the property that he's leasing from the city. And finally, the development patterns. The adjacent areas are developed as single family residential. If it's granted, this may open up the door for other properties, which are vacant, to go ahead and have exclusive recreational uses of the site. No houses, no one there to really look at what's being done on a 24-hour basis. These properties along the lake could be utilized solely as recreational or solely to store their RVs, their boats, to have picnics on the weekends without actual residential use happening on the sites. Three notifications were done. Two formal notifications were done for the Planning Commission meeting and the subsequent City Council meetings. The first 155 notifications were mailed out within an expanded radius, well outside of 200 feet. We didn't feel that enough people were being notified because it's next to a water body, so we expanded the range out. This original notification matched the legal description that we had for the overall 155 acres. Well, this caused some confusion, and so staff took it upon ourselves to hand deliver the very next day 74 notifications. So I went out even further and hand delivered myself in my own personal vehicle, well outside of the 200 feet, a more detailed, more specific explanation of the request, which fully delineated the 1.53 acres that was being requested as part of the special use. In addition to that, on a Saturday, we came in and we did 125 mailing to the residents within this neighborhood and an expanded range to let them know about these very same meetings that are being held before you, both today and what will happen in November, so that the residents would be fully aware that there was an ongoing process regarding this site and exactly what was being requested. Since those mailings, we received one response in favor and 20 responses in opposition. All 20 of those responses have been included in your staff reports and are available online. On September the 21st, the Planning Commission recommended approval of this request, subject to 6 conditions of approval that are in this PowerPoint and also in your staff reports. The action requested by staff, however, is to deny special use case SU-1502 to allow for accessory structures as defined in Section 402 of the zoning ordinance without a single-family residence in the single-family residential zoning district. Now, if City Council wishes to approve this special use request, we suggest considering the 6 conditions of approval recommended by the Planning Commission, which, as I said, are in your staff reports and which we presented to Planning Commission itself. I'm not going to read through each one of them, but I'm going to put them up briefly. And here's Exhibit B.
Back up, I didn't finish.
Yes, sir. And then this is Exhibit B, which is attached to those conditions, which would limit development to a very particular, a less than half acre parcel where any of these permanent structures, should you wish to approve them, would be located. So this concludes staff's presentation. We're available for any questions you may have. Thank you.
Rodney, is in your area. Do you want to take this? Did you want to have public comment first, or would you want to get
started? Well, a couple questions of her first.
Yes.
What was the vote in
The vote was actually 6-1. The chair voted against it. Against it. So everyone voted for it, she voted against it.
But you guys denied it.
We recommended denial, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
But the vote was 5-1.
To approve it. Yes, sir.
Okay. That was the first thing. When you said more traffic, I'm not understanding where you're getting more traffic from.
So we believe that by having permanent structures, that means there's going to be more use of the site, because more people can enjoy it in a more permanent fashion. So if you have to go out and put up a canopy, bring in your things constantly and take them out, you're likely to probably use it less. So if you put in permanent structures, you bring in an RV, you store it there, you have a boat, you store it there, more people are going to come out and enjoy it because there's more facilities to enjoy. So we feel that that permanency would equate to more traffic.
That's a lame excuse right there. First of all, driving down there too, have you driven in a vehicle out to the Do you know how many vehicles can go at a time?
Given the width of the road, probably two at a time in either direction.
They can't pass each other. So, I mean, it's very, very limited on how many vehicles you can actually even get out there to the island. And when we're talking about, you said a half acre spot out there on the end of the island, it's truly not even a half acre because the setbacks from the water cause it to be right in the middle. The only thing that can happen is basically right in the middle of the top of the island, correct?
Yes, sir.
So it's not a half acre out there. It's a very, very small area that they could possibly even do anything on out there. We're talking about one thing. A question I would like to ask, and I'm not sure if you know the answer on this, is the structures that were there and we made him take down a year and a half ago, I think. How long were those structures there?
I believe the applicant can answer that more fully.
Can you answer that? How long were those structures there? It was a storage building, I believe, and it was a covering over a picnic table.
Yes, sir. My name's Corridor. My father's asked me to speak for him. The blue awning, which I have pictures of, and I've included in an email that I sent to all of you, was there for about a year, maybe two. The awning over the picnic table and the small storage building that all we're after is the awning over the picnic table and the blue awning that we have. Anyway, the awning over the picnic table and the storage building were there since maybe 2000,
yeah.
2001. I mean, we started leasing it in 2000, so those were there for
a long time. I knew that they were there for a long time, and some residents across the way from you told me that they were there for a
and
long time.
Everything started about three years ago now, when the blue awning went up.
Right.
Which leads us to where we are today.
That's all I have. Questions I have from you. I'd like to actually hear your presentation and hear the opposition to this.
Okay.
Sure.
You know, in my stuff, I want to be very brief. Realize you'll have more important things. As I said, my name is Corey Word. My father's asked me to speak for him.
Corey, pick your microphone up just a little bit. You more taller.
Sorry about that. Like I said before. We've had ownership or leased the property since 2000, and I'd like to point out at this time, no other violations have been cited on my father or our family, besides the building without a permit or having accessory structures without a residence. There was, in the staff report that we received from planning, there was an open code compliance violation for a lighting issue. We have since contacted code compliance and found out there was no issue, or there was no, there was a complaint, but there was actually no violation. In the staff report it says that. Anyway, I just want to stress that anything that we do or that you guys allow us to do if approved would apply to the main body, which is the section that she's talking about, maybe the head of the rattlesnake, if you will. We enjoy this place. All we really are looking for is just the shade over the picnic table and the awning to be placed back on our property. You know, that's really basically all we're really looking for. As you can see, different views from like Gun Club Road, more views from Gun Club Road. We were instructed by municipal court to take these down about a year ago. We have been compliant this time for over a year, and we had a meeting with planning and legal. Mr. Bloom was there as well, and it was decided at that meeting that our best course of action was to apply for a special use permit, and that leads us to where we are today. I would like to answer any questions that y'all might have at this time, if there are any.
So the problem really arose when y'all put up the blue
covering.
That's the picnic covering had been there for 15 years or so.
Well,
yeah, at that time it had been there 13 or 14
years. Pretty much, yes, sir.
If this were to go through and you were to put that back, was there something in there about against doing the blue covering?
There was never a color put on one of the recommendations. Excuse me. At the planning commission meeting, there was no stipulation placed on that. At this time, no, I don't think so.
The other thing that I'll bring up is that multiple parks, when I was driving out there this weekend, multiple parks have covering over picnic tables. We have that throughout the lake area out there. So there's a lot of covering out there. So when you talk about putting up a temporary and taking down a temporary, First of all, we all know how windy it gets out there, and temporary structures do not do well out by the lake. So that, I can see why that would be a problem somewhat with you guys. Also, just the fact of having it covered permanently is nice, and it was covered permanently for at least 13 or 14 years without any problems whatsoever.
Correct.
So really, I think we're going back to, and but they made you get made you take that down.
That's
and
great.
You didn't put that up. That was up before y'all bought it.
No, we actually did put that up after we purchased the, leased the property, but it was right after, you know, we started leasing in 2000, I want to say in 2001, 2002, that's when that really went up. And the storage facility. But like I said, we're not even after the enclosed storage facility. All we're looking for is some shade. So that's really basically what we're looking for. And if you read our lease, you know, by definition, we can't build within 75 feet of the water line. I mean, we could request a variance or ask for a variance, but I mean, it would have to be a pretty big variance. We're not talking 5 feet, 10 feet. I mean, the island, as you can see in the, say on the back page, you know, at its widest point, we're talking 134 feet across. You know, it's so, I mean, we would have to ask for a very large variance to be able to build a residential structure on it. So by definition, part of the lease agreement, we're restricted to recreational use only. And that's all we're really looking for, is just to have some shade over the awning, or over the picnic table and over the slab there.
That's all the questions I have. Any other questions for Mr. Warden? Sure.
I have one comment. I did have two people from the Homeowners Association did call me and wanted me to know that they objected at the Planning Commission meeting, but after they left, they got information to show that their objection did not apply, and they're all for it and in favor. You know, so it's finally coming.
That was one thing I was going to point out. The numbers that I have were 20 people responded, not 21, but there was one in favor and 19 in opposition. Of the 19 that were in opposition, only 15 actually, or I'm sorry, of the 19 in opposition, 15 of those respondents referred to something about not wanting to change zoning, not wanting us to do something with 155 acres, which we're not, I mean, we don't lease 155 acres, and that there was too little information and too little time given for them to make an informed decision. So really there are only four people that were, that turned in a response that were against what we were specifically trying to do.
Mayor, Corey, let me ask you real quick.
Yes, sir.
I'm looking at this photo.
Mm-hmm.
Are you considering putting this up again the way it is?
We still own this. Yeah, it's at another property that my father owns, and something similar to that. You know, if there was a stipulation put in that the side couldn't come down that far, or,
would you consider going with a forest green cover? Maybe that could blend in with a.
If it pleases the council,
land there. And
no,
also,
thank
you. Is the reason this is longer here? Is it
just
the
side of the sign? Yeah.
Would you consider maybe some kind of a blind looking thing that slides down and back up? I don't know.
We're here to please
you
guys.
The blue stands out like a sore thumb. Mm-hmm. I think if you went like a forest green, it may appease some people. I don't know. But I just wanted to throw that in. And also,
somebody mentioned that. Somebody put it up. Yeah.
I'm the leaseholder, Carl Word, and I apologize that I'm in everybody's view. But you've got to look at what I look at. I look at 280 degrees of everybody else on the lake. And I'm not complaining of what they've got because it's a lake. And there are structures out there. I don't complain on the color of their house. I don't complain how they paint their structures. And I think I'm being held to a little tighter restriction than everybody else. I know it's a unique piece of property, but I'm a leaseholder just like everybody else. Yes.
I'm letting you. I kind of like that blue color. Anybody else? Then we'll open it up for public comment at this time. And we'll have anybody and everybody wants to talk to this issue, then step to the front. We'll give you ask you to limit to about 3 to 5 minutes.
Good morning, Council. My name is Jim Warrior. I am a member of the Lake Nashville Homeowners Association Board of Directors. There's two more board members here that will speak, one of them being the president of the association. I'm in the opposition here. I'm with the owners. All of our CCRs are not perfect. They can't cover every situation. In some instances, we say that if you put up a boathouse, it must be an open-sided boathouse, block views, etc. Now, Mr. Ward is going to put up an open-sided cover over his picnic table. And I personally see no reason why it should be rejected. There's all sorts of things about building a house and then having to have an accessory, but that Rattlesnake Island is not that big. They occasionally have parked a motorhome in the past. There is a whole rec area with motorhomes on that lake. There is a city picnic grounds where people put up temporary structures and camp overnight and do all that sort of stuff. I happen to have a permanent house out there, but as many other people do. But I see no reason why his request should be rejected. Now my other two partners, board members, will talk to you about it, a different light of it. But as an opposing board member, I'm all for approving Mr. Ward's proposal.
Thank you, sir. Trinidad, I know you can't tell me your name in 3 minutes. You're going to have to,
try. Trinidad Aguirre, I am the opposing, I guess is what I was labeled as. I am the HOA president for the Lake Nazareth Board. One of the things I'd like to do, Mayor, is keep the emotions out of it. I know that there's a lot of things that they would like to do, as a lot of us would. But we have two documents that I'm requesting that we adhere to. One of them is our CCRs. The request that he is proposing to us very clearly states that it is illegal to do this. We also have another document that we just paid $300,000 that you guys approved in 2013. That is the master plan document. That document also comes back out and highlights the fact that that area is going to be utilized or wishes to be utilized for a bike and a walking trail. By moving forward with this, our concern is we're going to be in violation of both of those. The other thing we looked at it was from 2 points. One of them, this is a blanket request. As all of the questions from you came about, you have no idea what you're approving today. He can do whatever he wants. All he has to do is go get a permit. Once you say yes, then he can go do whatever he wants to do within that land. You do not have an architectural drawing. You do not even have a pencil sketch. You don't have anything. And so our concern is, what does he really want to do? And why would we approve such a blanket document? This sets the precedent for other opportunities. I, for one, have a lease in front of my house, and I would love to get a special use to do the same thing that he's requesting. And why not? I've got a lot of other folks out there that are requesting the same. So let's not set a precedent. And Darlene was the same. She came back out, at the Planning Commission and said, variances are bad. And I don't like them because it goes against the grain. You mentioned the votes. We did have an annual meeting. The majority of the individuals voted against it. Those attendees, they did not want this there. They all can't be represented here, but they wanted to be sure that we represented them. I sent you a picture that shows the where Rattlesnake Island is and adjacent to the Red Slough area. If you take a look at that and you take a look at the housing around that, it's not just about a blue covering. That is an area that every morning you wake up, you go to your backyard, and that's what you see. That would be a perfect area for some artistic kind of item to be placed out there. But when you take a look at it, the blue awnings, and if you look at the subsequent picture, you can see what everybody saw. That is a prime location for all of our visitors, for the neighbors to take a look at. And again, we're very concerned that we're going to be putting up this kind of documentation. This was Santa Rita, if it was Southland, if it was Lakeview, I would not want this in my backyard. I would not want this kind of neighbor to be sitting next to me. And I promise you that if you took it to those areas, there would be a room full of people trying to oppose it. I also showed you in the master plan and implementation strategy that highlights it. It's on page 47, 48, and 50, where it highlights what the proposed use of this area is, and again, it's in violation. So from the legal standpoint, we have nothing against what they want to do, but as planning recommended, there are alternative options. We need to protect the wildlife, we need to protect the area. This is a vital area to the lake, and by having special exemptions, I think goes against the grain of everything we've spent money on, from the documentation to the CCRs and everything that you've asked us to do. So our request is that you vote denial. It's not the time, it's not the place, and this is not an emotional decision, but state of the fact. It is against the rules. Thank you.
And if you have anything else to say, I'm not holding you to time.
No, that's it. Unless you have any questions for me. Yes, ma'am.
You say it's against the rules, the Homeowners Association rules?
The CCRs, yes, ma'am. In 2000, the city approved our covenants, conditions, and restrictions, and in section 402, it stipulates that it may, that a an auxiliary unit may not be placed without a home, and that's what the planning department was saying. Since there cannot be, since there is not a home, it very clearly stipulates you cannot put up a carport, a garage, and in this case, we have no idea what's going on. I mean, again, you have nothing before you that outlines what's going on. It's a promise. I promise not to, but who knows what's going to happen.
Thank you.
With the conditions, though, that she brought forward, that would limit what they're going to be able to do out there.
It would not. What it would do is it would tell them that they can put up a structure, but it doesn't say that it has to be one, two, three structures. All it says that
there's setbacks though all the way around there, so you can only do it right on the tip of the top.
And I've been there. I've been to the property. I've been to the access road, walked the area. So from that, or you know, seen it from the boats. But so I did my homework on it, and you know, it's not a large area. It's big enough to accommodate multiple things. And that's why the homeowners, I mean, when you look at the pictures, it was ugly before. It was a very ugly, and it was done illegally. The residents got together, went through a court decision, and had it removed for cause. We don't want to go back in time and do this again. You know, there'll be other things coming forward, and we just don't want to go there. My concern is, what's going in there?
And well, I think we could make even a condition on there that he can only do two things. That cover... Those two covers, one of a picnic table.
But again, we don't want to do that. My concern is that, do we do this then? If we allow this for this resident, do we come back tomorrow and the next day and do it for everybody? You know, let's stick to the law. Let's not have variances. The variance says no, and I've got multiple people out there waiting in line that say, let's see what the council says, and then we'll come in with ours.
But do they have a peninsula that sticks out and they can't build something?
They have property they'd like to utilize for their benefit.
It's a very unique property, and I think it's really the only one out there that this would fall under. And I think, you know, if you start talking about opening Pandora's box, I think Pandora's box can be opened the other way around. There are these structures that are all over the lake out there that are not permitted.
Yes, I've met with, we're meeting right now with Code Compliance. I'm meeting with John James, and we are addressing each one of them. We're going after the docks first, and then we're going up to the substructures. So we are now having a very uniform process to look after the lake, and we'll be coming to you in various ways to help mitigate this. So we are working very closely with the planning department now, and we want to make sure that everything is done as it should be. So we are aware of those, and we are addressing them. And this is something else we have to address.
But talking about artistic or whether something is visually appealing to you, as far as my taste goes, I'm sure it's very different than your taste is or even than Marty's taste is. When I go out there and I look at properties out at the lake, I see a ton of properties. I'm going, man, that is terrible. They painted it terrible colors. They did terrible things. I see it on a daily basis. But when you said we should put something that's visually appealing out there, that's his property. I mean, this is visually appealing to him.
It is not his property. He is leasing.
It's his lease.
I have a lease too. I have the same lease he does, except mine's. And what it says is the city may elect to do, you know, if they recall it, for some reason, for instance, let's say that the master plan comes back and requests some other use, the city always has the right to take the action required because it is leased property. And right now we're working through that process. We're waiting for Gateway to respond. And once they respond, we'll have a better feel of what's going to happen to that area.
Well, I hope that you're not saying that we're going to start taking property away from people.
No, no, no.
I mean, that sounds really bad.
That, I cannot do that. That is beyond my purview. That is planning. That is Daniel. And only they can make the recommendation.
Well, I hope Daniel won't make that decision either. Yeah,
that's,
I
can't make that decision. That's beyond him. Yeah, that's beyond us.
Yeah, so that's off the table. I have nothing to do with that.
That's above our pay grade.
Yes, there you go. It's above my pay grade. Anyone else?
Any other questions for Trent before we move on to the next?
Thank you.
Come ahead, Ed.
I'm back as the head of the architectural committee. I'm Ted Lovin, again, as I said before. We have nothing against the words. I mean, I want to make that very clear. It is a Pandora's box, is the way we're looking at this. It's a situation where we've got $500,000 homes or more, 300 feet away from this island. Okay, well, this is what they see every morning. I live over on Hillside. I'm 1,000 feet away, but it's what I see every morning also. I'm just afraid, I'm not worried about possibly covering a picnic table. I am worried about putting up that blue cover and parking an RV under it again and leaving it for a period of time, which is in violation of the ordinances too, but it's hard to enforce these kind of issues. I mean, he knew when he bought this lot it was for recreational use only. And it's, you know, we've got, is it fair for him to lease a lot for 600 a year? Okay, and then he's got people paying some of the highest taxes in town, living 300 feet away. And they, you know, they have all the building restrictions and requirements and the space and setbacks to take care of it. He doesn't. But how this lease ever got to be an RS1 is, of course, I guess it's because it was designated as a park, possibly, or whatever, like Rebecca said. But to me, it's strictly for recreational use, should have always been left there, and that also puts a limit of a 5-year lease on it. I mean, at some point in time, the city wants to get out of the lease business. Well, this isn't going to help it when we've got things being renewed going on another 20 or 30 years out there. But anyway, we probably got 50 properties around the lake. I mean, we've got circles in Shady Point, we've got circles over there on Red Bluff Road. I'm sure these residents wouldn't want a storage unit put out there in the middle of these circles. But I'm afraid when we start opening up the special use, it's such a broad spectrum that we're going to have a lot of issues. And we just don't, we've got a lot of very expensive homes. And like Ronnie said, yes, we've had some things built that shouldn't have been built. But most of them were not permitted properly. They didn't come for us as an HOA. And we've tried to contain things yet be a helpful entity at the lake at the same time. But going forward, we just feel like when we look at these special permit uses, this is going to open up so many negative situations that could jeopardize the value of residential property in the proximity of them, and could change the overall environment of the lake. And that's we're wanting to see what Gateway is going to do. Apparently, they've addressed this vacation rentals also, but that's another thing that's, once it starts, we're going to have a big problem. So basically, at this time, what we feel that this permit should be denied, and that no permanent structures be allowed.
Thank you, Dan.
Just a matter of record for correction purposes, you stated that he paid $600 a year, and that's not accurate.
Well, I thought it was $598 a year.
I looking at his contract here in the computer, he's currently paying $1,140.
Okay, well, let's say $1,200 a year.
$1,186.
Okay. Well, that's, I just looked it up on the tax rolls, and apparently that hadn't updated or something. But even so, that's a very small amount when you've got people paying $6,000 to $10,000 taxes 300 feet away from it.
I'm sorry, now I'll correct me. I'm talking about his lease.
Yes, right, his lease.
Not taxes, his lease fees.
Right, right, but that's what I'm saying. I mean, he's virtually in a neighborhood, but he's not. I mean, he's so close to these residential lots that are paying the taxes. Is it fair to allow him to come in and pay such a nominal amount when these folks are being taxed at some big numbers? I don't like building something in a neighborhood around a bunch of $1 million, $500,000 houses and saying it's okay and this guy doesn't need to pay but $100 a month. Well, that's really not fair looking at the overall picture of the lake to me.
Thank you, Ted.
Any other questions?
Next. Morning, Mrs. Scotty.
Hi, my name is Scotty, and I represent the property that joins this, which is Lakeside Ranch Company, and it's right on the Dead Man's Curve. That property is mine, and we're bringing, as we build, extended, very expensive homes, and they would look right straight down upon this, and we'd like to see nothing but single family residents in this area. And that's it.
Thank you, sir. Further public comment? Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Mayor, council members. My name is Vicki Jewett. I've known Carl for 25 years or so. I've been out to Rattlesnake Island many times. It's always been well maintained. As far as looking down and the trash and the traffic, like I said, I've been out there several times for get-togethers. It's always been orderly. We've parked on the side of his road to get onto the island, and everybody works together getting off and on, and trash is always carried out. The island is always trimmed, mowed, clean. As far as the color of the awning, I don't know really if forest green would be any different. You look around the lake and boat houses are all different colors. The awnings over those are all different colors. So I vote that you should go ahead and let him put his shade up and enjoy his space.
Thank you, ma'am. It's 10:09. And I've had one request for a break. Do y'all want to continue with this, or do you want to take about 10 or 15 minutes for a break and then come back and get in?
Let's continue, finish it, and then stop, please. While we're on the road.
Leslie, do you want to take a break, or you want to continue?
I'm happy to continue.
Lizzie? Johnny?
Here.
Marty? Take five, y'all. Let's continue. Next. Good morning.
My name is Dean Harvey, and I've lived at the lake for 20 years, and I don't know why there's even a discussion here, really. It's just an open awning, everybody can see through it, and I don't see why just somebody can build what he wants as far as that goes, just the awning. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean. Good morning, sir.
Morning. My name is Steve Walls. I've got a place on Red Bluff Circle, not far from Carl's Island, what I call it. And I'm very familiar with it. It keeps, manicured, everything's in place. And there's no reason not to have some shade. That's really all you look for, some shade. And I can see it from my place there on Red Bluff. It's not a problem.
Thank you, sir. Next. Good Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Council. You too, Mayor. My name is Little Bill Kahutek. I live out at on Red Bluff Circle over there. We've been fortunate to own a piece of property out there for almost about 50 years. My parents have had a place up there. Back during the youth, we used to paddle kayaks past the Rattlesnake Island, going back to the hot water slough back when it was operational. We've been by that island for many, many, many times and seen it growed up completely out of hand, and we've seen it like Carl has it now. Very manicured, taken care of, really nice place. As far as that, the road going there, I think you're right in saying, it's got a big old pickup, and you can't even turn the pickup around there unless you go to the end, do it back up. But anyway, the place is immaculate. They do have some growth on the side of the island there. You got your reeds, and you got different types of brush growing up there. That covers up a lot of the building, but it's a natural growth. So, I mean, it's just not a awning that he wants to put up there that's just real plain. It takes a little bit to look at it. So, I'm all for it, you know. Let him have his cover out there. Nobody likes to really have their campers up sitting in the sun all the time. You know, it's going to be a little bit cooler on them. Let them go out there on the weekends, take the grandkids out, enjoy it, have a good time. He can hook onto it, take it back to his farm out there and park it until you get ready to go back. So, I see no problem with it. It's good.
Thank you, Little Bill. How big is Big Bill?
He was pretty good size.
More comment? Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Captain. I'm Paul Pascal. I do not envy your task. I know all y'all came into this to service and want to do things in a fair and equal manner. The only thing I've heard today is rules and staff. And, you know, problems are a result of decisions by they. And they, well, they could be you, they could be staff. Staff are bureaucrats. They're a self-serving entity. They don't have a dog in the hunt because they're going to get paid twice a month no matter what. And we've seen this lake out here go from little fishing cabins to these wonderful homes. I've been privy to building one out there that I couldn't live in because I couldn't pay the taxes on it. And, you know, y'all make this decision, and you inherited a broken system. Your rules are the charter. Well, the charter is just a broke document that y'all put your name on. You didn't even generate it. And if you go back and look at this charter, a lot of the things it really don't apply well to San Angelo. San Angelo is a very unique and gentle dynamic. And to bring in these things like Round Rock or Plano and expect San Angelo to behave like that, it's not going to work. So make the right decision. You can make the decision. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next.
I would just like to point out, Corey, we're getting. I'd just like to point out that anything between the homeowners association and the owner of the actual owner of a lake lot is a private agreement. If you're a leaseholder, you don't have to abide by the CCRs that are set forth by the homeowners association. So that, you know, I understand Mr. Gary coming up here and presenting that information to you, but we're not required to abide by those restrictions. Just to let you guys know that. Like we stated before, this is a very unique piece of property. We just hope that you, like Mr. Gary said, don't make an emotional decision based on information that doesn't exactly apply to our specific situation. And as far as opening Pandora's box, you know, like Mr. Fleming said, there's not another piece of property on Lake Nazarene that is dimensionally challenged, maybe, if you will, as this piece of property. Thank you.
Thank you, Corey. Any more public comments you need to get to the front now. We're about to close it down. If anybody else wants to speak to this, this is your last opportunity. All right. This is This is yours, Rodney.
Most of the properties that they were talking about, like he just said, where there's little circles out there, those properties actually aren't even on the water side, they're on the back side. So I don't see them as being the same type of property. And when we gave him this lease, this is a recreational lease that he has gotten out there and they do own. Well, there's a question on the wording on how it was worded.
Sir, it's actually a special lease. So it's a recreational and a single family lease. It's a special lease.
Right.
Yes, sir.
And, but I can see, when I think recreational use, I'm thinking sitting out, fishing, camping, being under an awning out there. I really, that's why, and everybody already knows how I'm going to vote on this, but I think that this is not something that can be comparable to the other properties. What I would like, I move that we approve this as presented with the six conditions Rebecca stipulated, plus in order to help out a little bit, I'd like to add one other condition that only two buildings can be put on there. The two buildings that were the same size, not buildings, the two coverings that were the same size that were there before, so that we cover anybody saying that there can be any kind of building, any size building, or multiple buildings out there. That would be what I would ask for. So the six conditions plus that. I move that we approve those.
You're moving to approve for denial?
No, not for denial.
That's the way it was presented. You said I moved to approve as presented, and it was presented.
I move to approve the special lease permit with the six conditions plus adding, with seven conditions. The two buildings that were there, the same size, the same coverings.
I'll second that. Okay. Do have a motion to approve as presented with the stipulations. Words, will that work for you? I do have a second on it, but just to get clarification.
Close the public hearing and now you're taking council comment and you haven't asked for any more comments.
Sorry, Word.
No, that's right. Yes.
I've already closed comment. Marty?
Rebecca, you said something earlier. I think I misunderstood. You said something about if it was allowed, it would increase usage or traffic.
The correlation was a permanent structure would mean that more people could visit because it's easier to come out to the site. It's easier to use the site. It's easier to enjoy the site. And so if it's easier to use the site, you're going to visit it more. Well, generally, because it's so isolated, because it's on Lake Nazareth, you generally have to drive there. So that would mean more vehicles on a road, which is built at 32 feet wide. So we believe there would be more traffic generated as a result of permanent structures on the site.
Okay, so it's really a safety issue as far as the road. Because I would think you would want increased usage of the lake.
We can post no vehicles that they have to get out and, you know, walk. Like the lady said, they park their car elsewhere and then they walk to the island. I mean, you can post it or pipe it off or no vehicle use. If
I think she's talking about general traffic. Yeah, you're talking about the general traffic.
On regular road.
I mean, if you built a house, there would be even more traffic than what he's talking about here, so I don't think you've got an argument there.
I think what they're talking about is traffic and traffic use is what you heard earlier today during public comment. You heard the comment about uses of houses or facilities at the lake, and if those are being leased out or generating a party or whatever. In this case, it may not be used, but that's what they're talking about when they're talking about traffic. The same issues we're talking about with other complaints you heard earlier today and how this property might fall into that same line.
John, do you have comments?
No, I just wonder what happens out there. I guess picnics, parties, family gatherings, is that what happens?
Can we speak?
Yes, I'm asking a question. Yes.
I do have friends. I have a lot of family. We do gather there for the weekends. We gather just like everybody else does on 4th of July, Memorial weekend, Labor Day weekend, and we try to afford to get there every weekend that we can. As far as the traffic, that's not an argument. It's going to be used the same with these structures or without. What we're asking for is shade.
You've answered my question. Yeah, now I know what happens out of it.
Thank you, sir.
John, do you have comments?
Hayes Feliz, that city previously had approved it, single family and recreation as a combination. I don't have a problem with the motion.
Ms. Lucy?
No, sir.
Lisbeth?
Oh, sure. I have some comments. I'm a little congested, which makes me a little less tolerant, so I apologize, Mayor. But I think there's a couple of things that come to mind here. I think for my comments and for the word family, this is not personal at all. When we're looking at a zoning issue, it has to be something that can be replicated for anybody and everybody, regardless of your character, regardless of your integrity or your ability to keep that little peninsula cleaned of overgrowth. But in the end, can we replicate this? And I think one problem for this is a site which probably never should have been leased with the idea that it be residential. If you can't build a home on it because of the setback requirements, it's like a lot of little triangles around town. I've lived in other cities where the city owns the triangle and maintains it, and in San Angelo, this city has avoided these all over the place because we don't want to be responsible for the maintenance. But they're not big enough to build anything on. So to me, this is one of those little funny pieces of land that's just problematic as long as there's any private control of it. I think they should be in the control of the city. We're not talking here about a variance. A variance goes through a ZBA process. But what we are talking about, I think, is a deviation from the planning, from the zoning ordinance. And I don't believe that a special use is any way to circumvent the zoning ordinance. And the question, like Mr. Aguirre brought up, would this be allowed in Santa Rita? I hope not. Would this be allowed in College Hills or Bryant Park or on the north side or anywhere else? No, I don't think in general that a single family residential lot should be used for any other purpose than the primary function be single family residential. So regardless of what any covenant says, that's what the zoning ordinance says, correct? So how did we help them get to a special use permit as staff? Can you tell me that?
So the zoning ordinance, through its use chart, allows for a very special and very unique process called the special use process. This special use process allows for transitional uses to occur if they can meet the criteria for, in fact, a transitional use. So in this case, it would be a transition between vacant open space and a single family residential. And so the argument being that a special use can apply in every use category in every zoning designation. And so if they can meet that criteria for a transition and the criteria spelled out for a special use may be requested and considered by council.
I think that we call this a park, but I realize we don't have a designation for a park, but to me a park is something that the public has access to. I think this is just kind of one of those. It's just a problem, and I don't think anything about this is perfectly clear. But as long as we're going to continue calling it single family residential, and as long as we're not willing to change the zoning on it to something else, I think this is just a roundabout way of doing just that, and I don't think that's being very transparent, and so I'll vote against it.
My few comments are, this is an and I went out there and I had to back out, and this is an extremely difficult location for a house. For one thing, the sewer is a mile away or half a mile away, and it's all uphill. It's a terrible location for a house. We also talked about the road being 32 foot wide. Well, the city just built as a developer a road at Howard College that's 24 foot wide and carries a lot more traffic than this road will ever carry, and it carries on a daily basis. So your road argument is completely out of the water. I can't agree with that at all. I would also like to say that not every house out there is a $500,000 house. There's a lot of houses out there that are far less than a half a million. And I also don't like your 200 foot notification, because any time the zoning changes as far in this city, you send letters to a 200 foot notification. That's the rule. And you've extended this for thousands of feet to pick up And that is wrong on your part. That's wrong on the city's part. Probably there should have been no notifications on this because I don't think anybody lives within 200 foot of it. So I've got a problem with that. And I also feel if we made him carry his carport and his shade down onto his picnic table, I do see a precedence there because I think everybody at the lake has got the same thing. They may be forced to tear something down too. So I don't like any of this process. I don't think it's fair to Mr. Ward. I don't think Mr. Ward's done anything wrong. I will support him on this. Do I have any further comments before I call for the vote?
One last thing. Just again, I want to point out that the zoning board voted 6-1
yes.
for approval. The planning board voted 6-1 for approval on this. So and they looked at it and they looked at the special use permits that were presented to them. So they were in favor, overwhelmingly in favor of this.
With the conditions.
With the conditions, and I want the conditions plus the last
he
condition.
Had a condition.
No, I know he did. I just said I don't want to be misunderstood. I think that the basic problem here is that it's single family residential, and I don't think it should be. And I think I'd rather go at it straighter in that respect than the way we're doing it. But I agree, the site itself is not. It's never going to be developed as a true residential lot. I also don't think the issue of who spends how much on their house is relevant at all here, or the color of the shade. We've been pretty tangential all over the place this morning, so I'll stop.
Sir, if you would like me to read into the record a proposed condition number 7, which may or may not meet
please
the
do.
Requirement.
Yes.
Number 7 would be read as accessory structures shall be limited to the two previous structures constructed on the site, limited at a square footage, so I will find out what that square footage is, or 600 square feet, whichever is less. 600 square feet, because that's what the zoning ordinance caps it at anyways. So if they had less on the site, that's what they'll be limited to. If it was over 600 square feet, they'll have to reduce it down so that it meets the zoning ordinance requirements.
Well, we want the same two structures
if,
there.
In order to be erected at more than 600 square feet, they would need a variance. The zoning ordinance is very specific on accessory structures. It's either a percentage of the principal structure, that is the house, or 600 square feet, whichever is greater. Because there's no house, they're limited to 600 square feet.
I agree.
So it's either what they had there before, or 600 square feet, whichever is less.
I'm sorry, guys. I think I have to go with her on that, because we don't want to start doing, that's just one more thing we're going to start doing where it's too big for the lot. Okay. Yes, I like how you worded it. I would accept that.
And I will give that to the city clerk.
Who seconded this? Shorter?
Johnny.
Y'all accept it. You accept that?
Sure.
Okay. All right. Motion has been made that we allow him to put the two structures back, maximum 600 foot, any color you want it.
Purple.
Contingent upon the 6 requirements of the planning. Six plus the one Rodney just added. All in favor of allowing this, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, nay.
Nay.
Put a 6-1 on that.